So, time then for the press preview. It's our first look at what is on the front pages of Thursday's papers. We're going to check out the headlines tonight with Andrew Pearce and Kevin Maguire. They'll be with us from now until just before midnight. Very good evening, gentlemen. We'll chat in a moment after we've had a look at those front pages for you, starting with The Telegraph, leading on fears that the price of a tank of petrol could hit £100 for the first time tomorrow. That's for a family car after petrol prices jumped by 2 pence today. £100 to fill family car is the headline for The Mirror, which calls the rise in fuel prices a petrol crisis. The Guardian also focuses on that hike in petrol prices, the biggest daily price rise in 17 years, along with a forecast that the UK's economy is set to slow to a standstill next year. The FT leads on the warning from the OECD that apart from Russia, the UK is on track for the worst growth in the G20. Well, The Times says the Prime Minister will tomorrow announce plans which would let lower-paid workers use their housing benefits to buy a house and end rules that prevent the use of welfare payments to get mortgages. 3 days of rail strikes at the end of June will disrupt trains for almost a week, according to The Eye, with just 1 in 5 passenger services expected to run. The rail unions have no shame, is the Metro's take after what it describes as a non-apology from the boss of the RMT union. Meanwhile, the Daily Mail has word that a coalition of charities and a border force trade union are mounting a legal challenge to halt plans to deport migrants to Rwanda. And The Sun gives its front page to news that the model Kelly Brook is engaged to be married. And a reminder that by scanning the QR code you can see on screen during the programme, you can check out the front pages of tomorrow's papers while you watch and listen to us. And I'm joined tonight by the consultant editor at the Daily Mail, Andrew Pearce, and associate editor at the Daily Mirror, Kevin Maguire. Great to see you both. Last time we spoke, it was before the Jubilee. Did you enjoy the Jubilee, Kevin?
Was there a Jubilee? Did I miss it? When was this? I must have, yeah. I think that weekend, if it was last weekend you're talking about, I went to see Top Gun, watched a bit of cricket. You know, it was a quite nice sunny time, yeah. Was it Jubilee? Jubilee, was it?
Well, the rest of us had a good time, I can tell you that. Listen, let's start. I mean, it's back to reality, isn't it, after all the fun last weekend. Front page of The Mirror, Kevin, says it all, doesn't it? £100 to fill the family car. Despair and fury as fuel prices are going to hit a record high. I mean, the records seem to be broken every day.
No, absolutely. Another 2p increase, talking about the biggest increase in 17 years. The RAC putting out that figure, the £2 litre on its way, which would be more than £9 if it was still shown in gallons. And it's probably the most obvious that manifestation of the cost of living crisis, because you drive past any garage, any filling station, and you will see the prices there. And it poses an incredible problem for families, households, anybody who uses a car, also people in the haulage business, public transport, and it's a huge headache for us. It's also a huge political problem for the government, because that 5p off fuel, which the Chancellor Rishi Sunak announced, has made next to no difference at all, and people are really feeling the pinch.
Yeah, and Andrew, there are also concerns that some retailers aren't passing on that 5p cut to motorists, and even those that are, I mean, it's a tiny in comparison to the increase.
Yeah, it simply wasn't enough at the time, and there was evidence that most retailers didn't pass it on. There was a time, you know, when the supermarkets used to have quite lively price wars on the petrol forecourts, because it was a great way of drawing cars in, but they're not doing that at the moment. And of course, the irony of this is the government's tax yield from fuel now would be probably another all-time high, because although I imagine many families are trying to fill up the car less because they simply can't afford it, at these prices, the tax yield for the Chancellor is going to be pretty huge, which I would think then can give him more scope to do more to help families, and perhaps sooner than the budget, which is not due till November.
Kevin, it sort of leads into another miserable front page as well, all about UK growth. It's set to be the worst in the G20, according to the OECD forecast today, apart from Russia, that is.
Yeah, it's a very unenviable record, the FT are leading on that. And of course, growth this year, 3.6%, is nothing to shout about, but it's not bad. But zero growth next year. Why? Why is the British economy doing so badly and so much worse in France and Spain and Italy, the US and Japan, all except sanctioned Russia, which is being penalised economically for invading Ukraine. All governments, all chancellors, all prime ministers, politicians like to boast about how the economy is doing well. Boris Johnson has done it frequently, as has the Chancellor Rishi Sunak. They won't be able to do it when Britain has just been absolutely clobbered. Now, inflation will fall, but it will mean another very, very poor time. And that will, again, squeeze living standards and hit the public finances. But why is it so bad? The FT doesn't explain it, but it is pretty, pretty awful. And it's a record you do not want to boast about. It's a record you want to be ashamed of.
Yeah, well, we put that question to the OECD today, and they said it's down to fiscal tightening, and that's one of the reasons. But also, they cited Brexit.
Well, I think actually the big factor here is the fact we're the only government in Europe that's putting up taxes. I can't understand why we're doing it. We're putting up national insurance. Crazy. Shouldn't have happened. I know a lot of people were taken out of national insurance, people earning up to £12,000. But far too many people are being dragged into it. And also, a lot more people are going to be are being dragged into the 40% tax rate, people who shouldn't be, police officers, that sort of thing. And we now know, don't we, that the tax burden is the highest in this country for 70 to 75 years. It's nuts. We've got to cut taxes to stimulate demand, to stimulate the economy. And Boris Johnson wants to reset his premiership after that bruising confidence vote last week, which, by the way, Keir Starmer oddly didn't mention at one of his worst ever performances at Prime Minister's Questions today. But he wants to reset his premiership by getting on the front foot policy-wise. But he's got to get on the front foot by sorting out the cost of living crisis first.
Yeah, it's the same story on the front page of The Guardian. Fuel costs surge and dire economic forecasts shatter PM's hopes of that reset. What do you think we're going to hear tomorrow, Kevin?
Well, from the government, we'll hear a lot of bluster, won't we? We won't hear from Boris Johnson an admission that he lied about Brexit and it's been a disaster for the economy. That's crushed trade. Had a huge financial impact, created bureaucracy. There's no benefits that you can see. He won't do that. He's just going to do his old boosterism and bluster. That's what he does. But he's divorced from reality. So you're not going to get the truth or any objective analysis from Boris Johnson. He's just going to dig in, and it'll be more of the same. More of the same. That's a disaster. That's what he's going to do up in Lancashire. We know he's going to speak, but we're asked not to reveal exactly where it is. Always said for security reasons. What they really don't want are protesters turning up to dog him. But Brexit, well, if that's crushing growth, he was the architect of that referendum victory, very narrow victory, divided the country, took a lot of energy out of other issues, spread a lot of poison. But he won't admit the truth because, he never does, and two, Brexit got him the job in number 10, but everyone else paying the price.
OK, Andrew, give me a very quick response to that, and then I'm going to ask you briefly about the front of the metro.
Well, the fact is, when you change a financial arrangement, which you've been in for about 46 years, it's complicated, it takes time. And I think we'll see the benefits of Brexit when we emerge from the post-pandemic economy. We've been battered by the pandemic. We've also got higher inflation than some of our EU rivals. So I'm not anything like as gloomy about Brexit as Kevin Maguire, who has never come to terms with the result in the first place, nor have any of his Ramona mates.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't remember when you were advocating Brexit, saying it would be terrible and would crush the economy. And
well, I didn't know there was going to be a pandemic.
You just never did. You never did.
Be a pandemic.
I would love to carry this on. We are out of time. I'm just going to show the front page of the Metro. It's about the forthcoming plans for industrial action on the railways. No shame is their headline. We'll talk about that after 11 o'clock. Hello again, welcome back to the press preview. Andrew and Kevin still with us. Front page of the Daily Mail, Andrew, Rwanda. And as I think many predicted, it looks as if there could be a legal challenge to that, to those first deportations.
Of course, there was always going to be. It's that Kevin's mates, the human rights lawyers, waving their legal papers, lots of legal aid, no doubt, involved. And it was always, there's this policy, many, many deportations, not just to Rwanda, many deportations of criminals back to various countries that are blocked on the runway by human rights lawyers. This policy is always, was always going to inflame the human rights lobby. And it's frankly a battle that I suspect Priti Patel, the Home Secretary, is rather looking forward to, because I think she'll find the public is on her side.
Kevin?
Look, I believe in the rule of law and that the law should be followed. And something like 7 in 10 asylum claims in the UK are found to be legitimate when people cross the channel. Andrew may not like it, but they are legitimate. So if you're going to put people unlawfully on a plane, they're entitled to appeal against it. And the policy of Rwanda is really to get pages, you know, from pages on the Daily Mail and so on. It's what Jesse Norman, the former Conservative minister and the Tory MP, very close to Boris Johnson in the past, said it's an ugly policy. It's just meant to inflame people. That's what it's about. It's also going to be hugely expensive. You can fall for it and want to be part of that ugly policy, or you could think we in Britain should be a civilized country and follow the law. You can do one, or you can do the other. I want to follow the law.
OK, Home Office insiders telling the Mail that the chances of the first flight taking off as planned are now slim. Very quickly, Andrew, quick look at this story. We've touched on it already. Announcement tomorrow. The Times seems to have a bit more detail when it comes to housing.
Yeah, so we know that Boris Johnson's going to massively extend right to buy, the great Thatcher policy of the 1980s on council houses, to housing association properties. 2.5 million people in those properties want more people to be able to buy them. But interestingly, too, a big change here, a big shift. It's suggesting for the first time he's going to say that people on benefits, they can weaponise their housing benefits to actually try to get mortgages. About £30 billion is spent on housing benefit every year. Prime Minister's point is most of that goes to subsidise rented accommodation. Why not to see if there's a way in which they can use that money to buy their own property, which would give people on much lower incomes a chance to get a foot on the housing ladder. Okay. If they can persuade the building sites and banks to go along with it, I think it sounds a really good idea.
OK, we'll talk more about that in a few minutes' time. Front page of the Times as well. Just give me 10 seconds on this, Kevin. Love drugs are on the horizon, according to Oxford University.
Yeah, according to, give your partner a love drug and you won't really bother if they leave the toilet seat up. Well, I'll believe it when it happens. That's what I will
do. I thought love drugs have been around since the 60s. My mistake. We'll talk more about that as well after 11.
Tell us more,
gentlemen,
you know.
Thank you very much indeed.